stifled, worn out, or just bored with your 9-to-5 or 9-to-9 job, I want you to know that you're not alone. I was there too, till I started asking and wondering if there was another way to live and work where I could actually be more of me. In this episode, I bring to you real conversations with real people who have chosen to step out of their 9-to-5 employment and create a life for themselves that is more in line with their inner rhythm. Good afternoon, Nitisha. Thank you so much.
Hi, Ramya.
Thank you so much for agreeing to come and speak to us as part of this conversation series.
And thank you so much for having me.
Lovely. And as you know, the intent behind the series is really to have showcased journeys of people such as yourselves and your learnings and examples for those who might be, you know, working in conventional 9-to-5 jobs, but are sort of looking out and wondering, is a life outside of this also possible? And can I make that for myself? So there would be, I know some of your journey, and from what I know about your journey, it's just pure and simple inspiring. It's fascinating. And I can only imagine the gift that it's going to be for other people to, you know, just learn and get the insider's perspective on whatever part of it that we can cover in today's conversation.
Thank you. Thanks, Ramya, for your kind words.
So to start with, do you want to just, take people through what your life when you were in a 9-to-5 job was like? Where were you working? What was your day like? What did it entail?
Okay, so while we like to say 9-to-5, I think it's more 9-to-9 or 9-to-11, 9-to-2 a.m. also sometimes. I was working at McKinsey & Company as a strategy consultant. That's where I joined straight from campus, from IIM Ahmedabad. And I was super excited to be there. It was like one of the day one job offers that come to campus. So without thinking much about work-life balance, everyone was sitting for it. So I sat for it too. And I landed up there. The work was super exciting, for sure. The people around me were extremely intelligent, great leadership qualities, lots to learn from. And I was enamored to be part of that environment. But I had no life outside of work. And while that was okay for a few months, then later it started to hit me that this is life. And if this is how I'm going to live, give 14 hours a day to work, then I have nothing else to call my own, not even my own health. My eyes were super strained and just that it wasn't a very healthy lifestyle for me. And that's where it started to kick in that this is not something for me. I remember that was at a 6-month point and somehow I managed to push myself that no, let's not give up now. Let's at least give it a year. So that's how the journey started.
And then what you did, what did you do after that?
So, well, I pushed 1 month after 1 month somehow and made it to a year. But and my project was ending, the project I was on at McKinsey. So I thought that was a good time to sort of, you know, like resign and move on versus starting a new project and being stuck again for 5-6 months. So I took that opportunity. I resigned. And I thought the best thing to do was to travel, to clear my mind and to figure out what I really wanted to do. So I took a 1 month trip to Latin America, which is near Mexico and Panama, that region, which is really different from anything close to home. So being in an environment which was so different, I guess that really helped me find what I was looking for. I realized I loved being part of nature. And the place is so simple. I remember meeting the sailor on a ship there, and I asked him, have you grown up on the island? Why did you never move to the city? And he said that in the city, everyone's living one on top of the other. Why would I do that? So that really hit me that, you know, I'm not even thinking about things like this. So I realized I want to live more simply, closer to nature. And that's the learning I brought back from that trip, that the next job had to be money doesn't define everything. It has to be more of a lifestyle decision for me. And that's when I found Trailblazers. It's a camping company in Bombay. Small team. We were about 15 people. We would work 9 to 6, and at 6 o'clock, everyone would pack up their bags and leave. And if you were still working, they would be like, "Oh, how come you haven't finished your work today?" It was the opposite.
Even a life beyond this.
Exactly. And the rule at office was that we leave our laptops at work and then we go home. So I was so stunned by this rule, because at McKinsey, I remember working at even like 2 a.m. at home, getting a call, changing PPTs. So that wasn't the case. And also Trailblazers, we would go camping. So I would go as camp director. And so it wasn't a typical 9 to 5. It was a hybrid, which helped me, take a baby step away from the corporate to now I'm running my own startup. So I'm really grateful for those 3 years I spent at Trailblazers, which was like a hybrid for me.
Nitisha, even your move, from quitting the first job, the consulting job, and then your travel and the experiences you got from that, recognizing that you really love being in nature and finding Trailblazers. How did that happen? Because that seems like a wonderful find as well, given what you now know about yourself. And how did that come about? So, did you have to look around? Did it just fall into your lap? Did you go out and search? Was it conscious at that point that you like nature, you like outdoors, you like camping, and therefore Trailblazers? Or was it the other way around, that experience began to point you into,
So it was actually an incident that I remember at McKinsey when I was sitting and thinking about, why am I doing this job? And I decided to step down for a cup of chai. And when I stepped down, I saw it's raining. And sitting in my office, I had no idea if it was raining or sunny. And I thought, okay, this is it. I need to be in a place where I'm more connected with the world. Wow. So I came back up. I was still in the McKinsey office. And I typed outdoor jobs. And a list of jobs came. There was elephant campaign manager at Wildlife SOS. I applied to that. There was Trailblazers for camp lead. I applied to that as well. And luckily for me, Trailblazers replied with a very interesting offer, because they saw my role was strategy. So they said, we'll give you a mix. That in office, you do strategy for us, and outside office, you lead camps, which worked perfectly because I was still in the comfort zone of my brain and the functions I knew while trying out a new area, which was close to my heart.
Wow. That is so amazing, So in the literature on careers and career transitions, we actually call that prototyping. And it looks like you got the, an ideal offer, something in which you could leverage the skills and the strengths you still had and not sort of throw it all away, and also have enough opportunity to try out and sample and experience a completely new space, one possibly that was tugging more at your heart and your body for the outdoors. Yes. And that's so nice. And so Nitisha, a lot of people, and I know this because I've been there and I know others who've been there, would just dream. So a lot of people in, for example, would have stepped down, seen the rain, realized that, oh no, sitting in my office, I'm not connected to, I don't know what's going on. I'm not connected to the elements of nature. Oh no, poor me, how miserable. And then not do anything about it. So two questions for you. One, what was it in you that says, I'm going to do something about this, and I'm going to find, literally start searching and take that next step? And second question, when you took that, did you have fears, doubts, resistances, worries, either inside of you or, sometimes they can also come from outside, like friends, colleagues, well-wishers, parents. Oh my God, you have all this education, you're getting such a great salary, you have this wonderful trajectory in ahead of you, and you're going to leave all this and go into something and, take a gamble shot following your heart. So how did you deal with this?
Okay. So your first question first. The salary at McKinsey was great. And I think that was something that helped me gave me more courage for sure. Because
that works both ways.
All that money was just saving up in my bank.
But Nitisha, the salary being great works both ways, doesn't it? I mean, yes, it gives you a salary cushion, but it's also that much more difficult to give up a great salary.
Okay. Yeah, for me, I think how it was different is that at McKinsey, I was at a case away from my home location. So they would take care of my accommodation, my food, my flights. I had a driver. I had everything. So I was literally not spending a penny out of my salary. And all that money was just piling up. So I reached the point where I was like, I have this money piling up and I don't have time to spend it. When I would ask for leave to go travel, then I would have to beg for one more day, 4 days. No, please give me 5 days. And that money was just piling up and piling up. So when I looked at that and I did a mental calculation that how many months can I survive without having another job? And I figured that if I live frugally, I could easily spend 2 years from my savings. So that gave me a lot of courage that I have 2 years of window to find my next income. So that was really like that moment, that was a golden ticket, sort of. Also, the fact that I didn't have any liabilities at that point. I had no children. I still don't have children. My parents are financially self-secure. So I thought that it's now or it's only going to get worse. If I get older, I have I'm married, I have kids, it's not going to be as easy. So those were two things that went on in my mind. And the third and most important thing was that if I had one life, what would I do? And I thought to myself, I have one life, so I have to do it. It's now or it's never. So that's when I mentally took the decision. But to answer your second question, when I took this decision back home to my parents, to friends, their answer was, no, you're rushing it. You know, it's just been a year. Give it some more time. Give it 3-4 years. And it just, I couldn't imagine 3-4 years down the line being like all gray hair and bent over with eyes, like dark circles. And it didn't look very optimistic to me. So I thought that, okay, no. I had to do a lot of convincing, especially to my father. My mom was more supportive, but my father, well, he was, I don't blame him either because there was a lot of social pressure on him that your daughter went to IIM Ahmedabad and now look at what she's doing. And that, I guess, was something that was difficult to deal with. This expectation that what if after this I failed, then the burden of, you know, someone who went to such a good college and didn't make anything out of it, that was the worst fear in me. And of course, there was FOMO of the salaries that they were offering, that 5 years down the line, I would be earning a crore or something like that. And my peers would be earning like that. So how would I cope up with that? That was a big fear I remember thinking about. But then I thought, what if I don't make it to 5 years? What if I die out of stress, out of a heart attack? So then it doesn't matter. So I thought, okay, now the time is now.
You know, Nitisha, what I hear you saying is, it's almost like you did these mini thought experiments in your head, you know, like asking, starting with that question, what if I have just one life? And then saying, hey, I do just have one life. So for everyone watching this, I think that's such a beautiful thing to do. If you've not done that, do that. And the second thing about, you know, visualizing yourself 3 years down the line, 4 years down the line, your future self, if you were to stay on the same path, right? And be the gray hair, dark eyed, eyes sunk, tired, and maybe you'd not even go there. I just think that's actually, it's very clever, but it also seems like one of the tickets that helped you break free of something that a lot of people don't, you know? So you just used your mind to create these scenarios and then create options which you could jump on. So thank you for sharing those. That's, wonderful. And did you have any fears or doubts? So did you, how did you deal with your father? And you know, I'm asking this because we all have fathers or we have mothers or aunts or uncles or husbands or kids or somebody who's going to tell us, no, don't do this. And because they come from a very caring, well-meaning place, but because also the vision that they have of a comfortable life or secure life or good life is different from ours. So,
yeah. With my father, I thought instead of giving him a decision, I wanted to take him through my thought process. So I started giving him those bits that were feeding into me. For example, one of my batchmates from IIMA, at 29 or something, he actually died out of a heart attack. And that is something that shook me up because I was like such a young person And probably the job stress was one of the factors, maybe not the only one. So I started feeding these bits of information to my parents too, so that they see what's the worst case that can happen.
That's very clever. No, that's really very clever. And yeah, expand.
And I would slowly, every few weeks, I would bring this up again in a small bit so that it's easy for him to digest. Because at once, like, his first reaction was no. But I knew he needed some time to accept it too, because I was needing some time to accept it too.
Yeah.
So I was playing some psychology with him. I kept feeding it to him every few weeks.
Yeah. And I don't know if you know this, but consistency is one of the 6 key principles of influence, as according to research. So literally, it's like, you know, you keep feeding these little bites again and again and again, just like the advertisers do to influence us, right? And so you used a wonderful strategy with your father there. So
yeah, but eventually, even like after a couple of months, he still wasn't on board. So then I finally thought, okay, now I have to take that leap of faith for myself and for him too. So then finally, after I actually put in my formal resignation, I came back home and I told him, okay, now it's done. So he was mentally prepared, and the final blow was a final blow.
Yeah, and you did your best to soften that blow ahead of time and get him. Very nice, very well handled. Thank you for sharing that. And what about you? What was your number one or number two fear, if you had any, or doubts?
Well, the fear was, so I knew that finding income would not be such a problem, especially given, like, thanks to, you know, my university degree, I knew that I would find a job as a receptionist or something, like, worst case. But the idea was, would I be able to find work which I enjoyed and still manage to maintain a work-life balance? Because I was sure I didn't want to give up on the work-life balance, and I still wanted to be intellectually stimulated. I wanted my heart to be tickled. So that was the fear, that would I be able to do that? And the second thing was, now I'm moving towards an outdoor industry, and I personally had no real skills to offer in such a place. So I thought, okay, what kind of a job would they offer me, and would I be able to deliver? That's another fear that I had. But thankfully, the universe just, I guess, supported me in that way by offering me this hybrid role of strategy with camping at Trailblazers.
So how did you overcome the first fear? The second one, you got something, right? So you got the hybrid role. But the first fear, how did you overcome that?
What was the first fear again? What did I say?
Or would you be able to find a job with the work-life balance?
Yeah. So I knew that, okay, then when I was applying to outdoor industries, I knew that... over there, it wouldn't be as hectic because they're not looking at like high growth and profits and things like that. So the work
would be better than what you already had. And then you tested it out. Yeah,
exactly. So at Trailblazer, sometimes if I would work till 7 p.m., it seemed very okay. Even though at 7 p.m., everyone else was like, you know, it's 7, we're working so late today. But I would be like, no, late is 2 a.m. 7 is early. And also... the fact that I thought that in case I don't, like, it's okay to start over again. So if I didn't get a role, which was maybe, you know, to my skill level, I was okay to go down a few levels lower and start from there in an area that I like, because I would still be learning. So I was okay with that compromise and not thinking of the designation and what my batchmates, their designation was. That was, like, the biggest block in my mind. But...
So I really like what you're saying, because so there is this concept that, you know, I use in my work, which is ROTI, which is return on time invested in any work. And we often think of it, you know, the most straightforward way of thinking of it is the salary or the compensation and money, but in reality, there's so many other things that we get from our work. And what I just hear from you is the way you started looking at the option that you were going for at Trailblazers was, there's going to be the learning, there's going to be the outdoor experience, there's going to be the creation of new skills for this kind of life, and really looking at all of those as inputs, not just the salary. So it's nice.
And let me add that the salary that they were offering me was half of what I was earning previously. And I knew that that was still a lot because for a company like theirs, and the industry doesn't pay so much. So it was something I had to accept that, you know, I can't compare it to my previous salary. I need to think about what I need to live right now. And is that enough? And that was the calculation that I did.
Absolutely. So nice. So, Nitisha, this is, so going beyond Trailblazers, what did you do next? Take us through that phase of your journey, the next transition.
Okay. So after about 3 years at Trailblazers, I reached a point where I was again beginning to think that if I had one life, and you know, what could I do? I wanted to dream wilder, so to say, because my wild dream had worked. So I was pushing my boundaries. And
you had,
I wanted
you had
to
found the wildness down. In you, even more. You had stepped up the wildness in you by that time.
Yeah, because by then I had gained some confidence. I had gained my balance. So I was ready for the next step. And I really wanted to take a travel sabbatical, travel for a couple of years. I'd heard stories of people like Steve Jobs and so on, who backpack around India for a year. And I always wanted to do that. And at that point, I was single. And I thought that, okay, this is the best time. Because I don't have a partner. So it's easy for me to be nomadic. And so I put down my papers at Trailblazers, ready for this year of backpacking around India. The plan was to play adventure sports all over India, start in Kashmir, ski there, and then go down, surf, paraglide, do all sorts of things. But 3 weeks into my so-called travel sabbatical, the lockdown happened, the first lockdown. And I was back at my parents' place in Calcutta, now without a job, without a purpose, because I had planned was, okay, I'm going to travel, and I had my money saved up for that. And now I'm in this place where there's no travel. I'm doing the opposite of traveling, just being locked down. So that's how it started. But now when I look back, it was a sort of a blessing, because that time helped me to think about like a business idea behind the travels. So my 3 weeks in Kashmir gave me some good meat, like food for thought, because I saw the ski industry and I saw the treasure that Gulmarg is for skiing. But because Kashmir had internet issues and so on, they were not being able to reach out to the rest of the country or the rest of the world. And I thought I could be that marketing partner, the last mile between the ski shops and between the customers. So I came back home, and during this lockdown, I put together this idea where I could be the last mile for different sports in India. And that's where my startup journey started, in the lockdown in my room. I remember using chalk and writing all over the cupboards, putting together plans. I didn't have too much money to spend to invest in. So I thought, what do I have instead? I have a lot of time. So I thought, okay, let me just, instead of outsourcing, I started playing with logo design, with website design. I took some coding classes online and started to put together a website. And yeah, 3-4 months later, I had something which I was happy with, and I was happy to share with the world. And it's called Adventure Play. That's my baby right now.
There are just, and you know, want to hear more about that baby. But before that, just sort of pulling out so many lessons from your journey so far, you know, just for our viewers, and also to just reinforce in myself, because the first lesson here is really about, you know, how we plan things, but they don't always need to go that way, really. So you plan to travel the world, and that is the vision with which you gave up this lovely job at Trailblazers. But it didn't work out because the lockdown happened. And that would be, you know, a typical moment where a lot of people would have gone, oh no, my plan is ruined. Oh no, I made a mistake. Oh no, this is bad. And perhaps you went through that also, but even if you did, you pretty much bounced back into, okay, how can I now make this work for me? What do I have now? And I heard one of the stories that one of the questions you asked yourself, what do I have in excess now? Which I have excess of time. So what can I use with that? So another beautiful example of you asking yourself a very pertinent question. The other thing I loved about your story is you had those, was it 3 weeks or 3 months in Kashmir?
3 weeks.
3 weeks, right? You had a 3 week experience and you totally milked it. You really looked at, okay, what have I learned? What is good about it? Understood whatever you could about the skiing industry, spotted the opportunity there, spotted an opportunity there. And again, you know, what strikes me is you spotted an opportunity that was in line with some of the skills and gifts that you already had, which, you know, you had been in the space of strategy, you know, you had an MBA and possibly was marketing one of the things that you got exposed more to at Trailblazers. So
yeah,
you had that as, you know, a skill as well in a similar industry. And you started looking at how you could put that to use. So I just think it's a lovely application of the resources you had and the experience you got. And this is just the perfect elements that make for crafting your life. But go on, just beautiful.
But it didn't start out like that.
Yeah.
It didn't start out like that because I've been playing adventure sports for quite some time now, maybe a decade or so. And I tried different sports and I liked a lot of them. I liked scuba diving, I liked surfing, skiing. And often my friends and family would tell me that choose one sport and become an expert in that versus, you know, just being all over the place. And I often thought about it, but I thought that, no, I want to do all of these things, which is why I'm doing it. It's not a strategic decision. And when during the lockdown I was thinking of this idea, I thought that, you know, now this is working to my advantage. I have some idea of a lot of sports and I can be this last mile person. So I guess some, like, when the time is right, then things look like they're falling in place. But
yeah,
before and after, they don't look like that.
And we hear everything. We hear it both ways, right? Jack of all trades, don't scatter yourself, pick one, choose one. Not necessarily. And you're a perfect example of actually saying, no, I'm interested in all of them and I'm going to do something with all of them. So what did you do next?
The lockdown was starting to open up and I thought that if I have to do this year of travel while maintaining courage and while maintaining peace of mind, then I need to do something which I'd been wanting to do for a long time, which is a yoga course. So I signed up for a 1 month teacher training course in Rishikesh. I thought that could be the perfect base to build my life over because I was really at a point where I was questioning things like, what am I actually doing in life? Like, I'm trying this, I'm trying that. What do I want to do? Where am I headed? Those were questions that were springing up, and I signed up for the course, and then everything started to make sense to me through the course. The course is great, and I would recommend it to anyone because it's not just about asana, it's also about the philosophy of yoga, which is spoken about in the Vedas, and it just brings all aspects of life in harmony together. So for me, after that, my mindset towards
Nitisha, give us, you know, give us one or two things that you picked up from yoga, which, you know, which you're carrying forward with you in the way you're living your life and conducting your business, because it's so beautiful. But I don't know how many people are going to go and do the course in Rishikesh. But I really want to know, you know, what you're carrying with you.
So for my work, it changed my mindset completely because I thought, okay, numbers mean nothing. I didn't want to be chasing numbers anymore. That's something that yoga taught me. I wanted to be happy with, like, not expect too much. And, you know, in a corporate setup, you have all these targets and you're tracking these numbers. And I wanted to consciously move away from it. I wanted to do my best and what came, came. So, for example, for my social media of Adventure Play, I put up an Instagram thing. So I wouldn't take it personally, the number of likes, if they were less or more, and I wouldn't brood over it. It was just what it is. I was doing my best, and the numbers didn't mean much. So that's something, And the second thing I remember taking from the course is how to approach sales. So I didn't want to be this pushy sales person where I'm trying to sell things which the universe doesn't want, because that's not how harmony works. So only if there is a gap and someone needs it can that gap be filled. And that's the kind of mindset I take for for the sales I do at Adventure Play, that if someone truly is interested, they will come and they join the sport. And I don't want to push it and oversell things just for the sake of numbers. And that's given me a lot of peace of mind. So I think of myself as a shopkeeper. You know, there's a shop near where I'm staying in Rishikesh. And often when I go to the shop, sometimes the shopkeeper is just sitting idle, looking out, waiting for customers. That's his dharma, to sit and wait for customers. And some other times when I go, it's busy, it's packed. There are 5 customers waiting in line. So I thought of myself as that shopkeeper. When there's no business, my dharma is still to wait and to do my best versus really worrying about, oh no, there's no business right now.
Nitisha, that is so beautiful. I cannot tell you, as a business school prof, how delighted I am to hear, to listen to the way you've interwoven, you know, your learnings from pretty much the heart and essence of yoga into the way you're doing your business and the way you're creating it. And yes, it's not just about the asanas or the pranayama and not just about a way of life, but, you know, you can actually take it into your work. And thank you for, you know, those very, very nice examples. I remember hearing a few more examples you had used in an earlier conversation, but that's okay. We'll move on. but it's really, you know, this example is beautiful. And going to ask you one more thing about, you know, the role of what keeps you going despite the challenges. And, you know, given that you started at a time during the lockdown and the ups and downs, and the role of your heart connect, you know, some people call it passion, some people call it a deep interest. You could call it dharma, I'm not sure, but, you know, how do you see that? Or soul's calling, or heart, you know, something. So
ever since I got into adventure sport as work, life has been very different, because now there's no more work and there's no more play. It's all life. So, for example, today morning, I went for my first kayaking session this season to the Ganga. And that was work for me. Like, going there, paddling from 9 to 1, that was very much work for me.
You've got to call that, yes, going for a kayaking session in the Ganga is work for me. Absolutely.
And that's also play for me. So it's very mixed. And similarly, when I wake up in the morning and I do my yoga practice, that's work for me too, because I need to be fit to be able to do these sports. So I'm trying to make my life in such a way that there is no work and play. It's all moving towards where I want to go. And that's something that's keeping me going. And it's again, that thought.
Sorry. And it's all moving towards you being more of you, right? So the desire to get fitter is also connected to your being able to do that work better. And it's just so beautifully, you know, connected to bring out the best version of you, for you to grow into better versions of yourself.
About adventure sport, because that is something which is very directly related to my work. But I started picking up the ukulele recently, a few months ago. And when I started to play the ukulele.
Okay, that's a ukulele. Okay.
So it's like a mini guitar. Mm-hmm. And now when I spend, say, a couple of hours in the day practicing it, that's also work for me. So I don't count that as playtime, because it is hard work to sit and practice. And that's also something which is leading me towards where I want to go. I want to be more, I want to start loving my voice more. And this is something that helps me do that. And that's part of my pursuit of life. So I look at life as just life now. There's no Monday, there's no Sunday. On a Sunday, I work, I do yoga, I play sport, I play ukulele. It's every day is the same.
And you also write, and you've written a book. Do you want to tell us about that? About how that book is also an outflow of you, your journey, your work, your play, your life.
So the book happened. It's a classic when life gives you lemons kind of a story, because after like setting up Adventure Play, launching some of my first courses and them doing really well, the ski course and so on, the second wave hit. And 1 year later, I was back at home with, again, nothing to do. And I had already set up the business, so I didn't even have I didn't want to create another business for sure. So I was like, okay, now what do I do? And I'd been wanting to share this knowledge that I had learned at yoga in some way or the other. Some people had been asking me, why don't you write a blog about it? But I knew a blog wasn't enough because there was so many angles to it. So I was toying with the idea of maybe writing a book. That was a lifelong dream ever since I was a child to someday write my own book. And I thought now is a great time because I have nothing to do. I have all this time on my hand. And it can be an experiment. If it goes well, great. If not, then it's okay. So yeah, that's how the book came about. Thankfully, the lockdown lasted long enough for me to put it. But also the pressure of, okay, once season starts, I want to be back on the road. So that helped me to finish it early versus some people can get stuck in the book and it can become a procrastination journey. But that incentive that, no, I want to be done with the book when I'm back on the road and sort of starting my second year of all of this. And the second year was starting with me joining the advanced yoga course. So it was all like coming together in a nice way that, you know, I've finished this 1 year and it's Outbound is releasing and then I start my next year and let's see what comes out of that. So that's how the book came about.
Beautiful. And we're going to put a link to where people can find your book in the description for this video. And, you know, hearing you speak about your life, Nitisha, it's just like this unfolding. An unfolding, you know, in layers, like a flower blooming, but different parts and aspects of you as that flower blooming. And what really, really I love about your journey is how every time there's been a constraint, you've turned it into an opportunity and created something beautiful out of it. Once a business, first lockdown business, second lockdown book. I mean, you know, who does that?
And I hope there's no third lockdown. I'm running out of ideas now.
But, you know, even if there is, I don't think it's going to stop a person like you. And that's why, you know, I want to have this conversation. I don't think it should stop any of us. I don't think any number of lockdowns, any number of hurdles, any number of constraints or lemons should stop any of us, you know, because if we can be as creative as you, bold, ask questions and keep making different kinds of lemonades, different flavors, depending on the lemons that are tossed our way. That's just such a beautiful unfolding journey of experiments. And
there's something that helps me with that, which is I have this note on my phone of dreams, just like things I want to do in life. And I keep adding to it as and when it's been going on for the last 10 years, maybe. So there are things like creating a board game, just like random things that I want to do sometime in life. And when I find myself in situations where I have nothing to do, I look at that list and I see, okay, from this, what can I do right now?
That's wonderful. Okay, so one more thing for anyone listening to this to note down. And how many things do you have on that list? I'm just curious here. And when did you start adding to that list? 10 years ago.
Well, maybe there are like 10, 12 things.
Wow.
Yeah, a lot of it is the travel and like going to Antarctica, diving there. There's a lot of different things.
Yeah, no, I think it's so, so powerful. So, I mean, I actually teach courses in which I'm a huge believer in goals and visions and literally, right? Because we need something to direct our energy and attention towards. And I see you doing that so fabulously, amazing. So literally not letting anything stop you. And if it stops you this way, you pull out something else from your note and you focus on what you can do at that time. Hats off to you. So
yeah, but I won't lie. There are moments where I feel useless and I feel like, okay, what am I doing in life? I'm not doing
much. Tell us what you do in those moments, because we all have those moments. I have lots of those moments. So I'm glad to hear you have them too. What do you do when you go into those spaces?
Yeah. So I remember this one Monday, the beginning of lockdown, and it was maybe 11 or 12 in the morning, and I was feeling like that everyone's off to work. It's Monday morning and I have nothing to do. And I tried to reach out to some friends and everyone was like, I'm at work. And it just hit me even more that, you know, what am I doing? Everyone's at work. Well, moments like this, what I usually do is reach out to friends. So luckily, my friends from school are an artsy bunch. There's an artist, there's a textile designer who've been using this freelance model for quite some time now. And I go to them and they tell me that it's okay. And you don't have to constantly be at it. You don't have to be the Skype person. Learn to relax, go watch a movie. And that part is a little difficult for me. I'm usually very highly rajasic, as it's called in yoga. I like activity. To calm down, that's a challenge. So what I would do instead is, when I would switch on Netflix, I would watch a documentary, say, on kayaking or on surfing. So it didn't feel like all play. It felt like, okay, it's like somewhere related to my work. I'm still working.
You're doing your market research. Gaining domain knowledge. Yes. Yeah. And it's important. Wonderful. So Nitisha, we'll wind up soon. But before we wind up, so just, putting you in the sort of hot seat, and you've been giving us lots of tips and taking us through your journey. But if someone were to ask you, what would be your three main points of advice? And if advice sounds too heavy, but, just suggestions to someone who is currently in a 9-to-5 job, and not someone who's happy with it, but someone who's feeling like possibly how you felt the day it was raining outside and you realized, but I'm trapped inside this building. What would be your three starting points for that person?
Well, the first would be savings, because all this sounds very dreamy, but it's better to be practical about it. And if you have savings, it just becomes so much more comfortable. So what I would say is have savings. Think of how many, like ideally a year worth of being able to live without needing an income. And that's just the first level of savings. So I would say try to think of multiple levels of savings. There should be a rainy day fund, which is not touched at all, no matter what. Like a solid health insurance or a health fund for sure. And yeah, then this 1 year of living. That would be my number one advice. That it's, don't just dream without having a backup plan. And the second would be have lots of backup plans. When you leave your job, then at least have some idea of what you want to do or the industry that you like and you want to explore. But at least some starting point, because you don't want to quit your job and be lost that, okay, what am I doing? So, and everyone likes something or the other. There are these things. So it's just about knowing, okay, these are like three industries I want to explore, and then going out and exploring. And the third would be do it when you have the least liabilities, which is now. For everyone, the answer is now. Because you never know what's happening a couple of years later.
Oh.
You have old parents, they're getting older. You are getting older.
I just love that. I got goosebumps all over. I was like, okay, what's the time of least liability? And you're going to get quoted on that, young lady. Now, of course, it is now. Such wisdom. Thank you. And I know that was supposed to be the last question, but there's one more last follow-up question, which is, what is one thing which you know now, which had you known years back, and for you, it's just like some years back, but would have made your entire journey more easy and joyful than it's already been?
Well, the one thing is that if you do good work, then money comes your way. Because if you do good work and the universe wants that work, the world needs it, then you are going to get compensated for it, because people will make sure to keep your work alive. So that's something which earlier I would be scared, okay, what if I don't earn enough? But it's about just doing with the idea of, of seva in a way, that you're doing because you genuinely feel that there is a need to do for this to be done. And if that's the case, then the universe will support you to do it. And if it's not supporting you, that means what you're doing is probably not needed. So do something else.
Or find another way to do it or modify it. Love. Yeah. I'm going to put that in bold and italics, Nitisha. And that's so beautiful, right? So tell me if I've got this right. If you're doing good way, you will be supported and the money will come for it, right? The money will come to you and you will be. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Beautiful. Okay, thank you so much. And it's been a joy and pleasure, seriously, talking with you. And I have no idea how many others you're going to be an inspiration for, and how many people you might give courage to by, you know, sharing your journey in all its rawness, through your ups and downs, giving us the tricks that you used inside your mind, knowingly or unknowingly, but really the creation of these beautiful questions. You've been using very powerful questions in your mind to navigate yourself through what you've done. So thank you again. And it's been a joy and pleasure. And wish you all the very best of luck. And we're going to put more details down here so people can reach you and get a copy of your book as well. Wish you the best.
Thank you, Ramya. It was a great conversation. I had a great afternoon talking to you.
So glad. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.
If you are someone who's looking to craft your life and work in a way that is more in line with your inner rhythm, then do visit my website, www.craftingourlives.com. You'll find it in the description, because I have a host of resources put together for you. And this is based on 20 years of my own research and work, and work with people as a coach in this area. I also have a free newsletter, so your starting points should be to sign up for my newsletter, subscribe to this channel to stay updated for further videos, and to go on to the edX site and look for my free MOOC course there, titled Crafting Realities, Work, Happiness and Meaning. And then reach out to me if you need further assistance. I also offer private coaching, as well as I run group coaching sessions, and I also conduct residential retreats. And you can find all that information on my website or in the newsletter as and when we announce it.